Hello, my name is Caleb Frelick, and I'm an electrical engineering and mathematics student at Walla Walla University. And today, we're going to be talking about binaural recording and how you can be surrounded by sound. So what is binaural recording? Well, in short, binaural recording is a recording strategy that places you, the listener, in the exact same sound field as the original audio, the intent being to create 3D stereo sound. Dr. Edgar Shoari, a mechanical engineering professor and head of Princeton's 3D Audio and Applied Acoustics Lab, had this to say. Binaural recording allows you to hear a bird flying over your head and a whisper in one ear. For decades, binaural recording was a novelty and overlooked for less technically demanding methods. But with the rise of virtual reality hardware like the Oculus Rift, Sony's Morpheus, and Samsung's Gear, systems dependent on realistic 3D audio to fully immerse their users, binaural audio is on the cusp of a renaissance. So how is sound recorded binaurally? Well, traditionally, recordings have been made using two methods, mono and stereo. Mono uses a single microphone to pick up sound, while stereo uses two, spaced apart from each other. Binaural recording takes the stereo method one step further by placing two microphones in in-ear-like cavities on either side of a stand or dummy head. Because the dummy head recreates the density and shape of a human head, these microphones capture and process sound almost exactly as it would be heard by human ears, preserving interoral cues. The effect is best experienced over headphones, with a clear distinction between right and left perspectives. It's a simple concept, I know, but when done with high-quality microphones, the effect is eerie. It fools the brain into believing it's hearing the sounds firsthand. Now, the binaural audio recording is very expensive. The setup seen to the right, which includes the dummy head, a set of microphones, and a condenser, is reasonably priced at $8,400. Other recording setups can be upwards of $20,000. Obviously, this upfront economic burden would be insurmountable for someone like me who just wants to mess around and play with 3D sound. Furthermore, even if one had the resources with which to invest in a binaural recording setup, would there be a way to convert a single mono-channel recording to binaural audio without having to re-record the entire thing? Well, just the very nature of me doing this project should give you a hint. Yes, of course there's a way to convert pre-recorded audio to binaural audio. One of those ways is by using BRIR's, or binaural room impulse responses. BRIR's are just a pair of impulse responses, one from a source position to the listener's left ear, and one from the source position to the listener's right ear. Thus, BRIR's depend on the location of the source relative to the listener and geometrical properties of the environment in which the impulse responses are recorded. Now, BRIR's can be obtained by solving the wave equation in a room using a numerical method. However, nobody really wants to do that, so impulse responses are recorded in the studio by playing back an impulse of a full range of frequencies, typically the audible frequency range, and then recording the response using a binaural microphones. Using this recorded impulse function, the BRIR's, and convolution, an audio file can then be transformed to sound like it was recorded in the location of where the impulse function originated. For my project, I had three goals. First, I wanted to take a single channel audio file and convolute it with a BRIR to produce a binaural audio file at a single position. Second, I wanted to convolve multiple BRIRs with sections of the same audio file to create the sensation of a moving sound source. And three, I just wanted to have fun messing around with audio spatialization. For this project, I chose to work in Python, and I used JupyterLab as my development environment. After a bit of research looking for BRIRs, I stumbled across the open access ASHIR dataset, which gave me a set of equalized BRIRs that could be used to simulate a variety of rooms, including control rooms, listening rooms, seminar rooms, studios, and many more. There were 25 rooms in total, and I only really needed one, so I used R1 in my work, which was essentially a recording studio with no reverb. There were 20 different BRIRs, all with different azimuthal angles. Let's listen to a few of them. Here's the BRIR when the azimuthal angle, which I've called theta, is equal to 0. From listening to the audio and looking at the impulse functions for the left and right channel, we really can't differentiate between the two impulse responses. This is because the distance between the source and the listener is the same when theta equals zero. When theta equals 90 degrees, we get different results. Take a careful listen. We can distinctly hear the right channel over the left, and plotting the impulse responses in time, we see that difference between those two channels. When theta equals 90 degrees, negative 90 degrees, we get the opposite result of what we got when theta was equal to 90 degrees. So just to make sure that your ear has heard the differences between these impulse functions, I'm going to go play those three impulse functions again consecutively. We'll start with theta equals 90 degrees, in essence your right ear, and then move counterclockwise and end up at theta equals negative 90 degrees, or your left ear. Here we go. All right, now how can we use these BRIR's to accomplish our project goals? Well, we know from signals and systems that if we know the impulse response of a function in an LTI system, we can determine the response of any signal using the transfer function of that impulse function. The tool that we need to accomplish this is convolution. In our case, we are thinking of convolution as kind of like a filtering operation, where the impulse response is a filter that operates on our input signal, the audio file. Now, I did all my work in Python in a Jupyter Lab notebook, and for the sake of brevity, I won't show all the functions that I wrote. Instead, check out my GitHub, the link will be in the description, where I've placed a copy of my notebook. So the first thing I wanted to do was to create a binaural stereo audio file from a single channel audio file. Here's an audio file I grabbed off the internet of two chords being strummed on a guitar. Taking the convolution of the guitar audio file with each channel of the BRIR, theta is 90 degrees here, gave the following responses. Individually, there's not a significant difference between the two channels. However, when you put them together into one stereo audio file, you can notice a significant difference. Take a listen. Pretty cool, huh? Now, how can we use this to make music spin? Well, all we really need to do is to take an audio file, chop it up into little pieces, convolve each of those pieces with separate impulse functions at different azimuthal angles, and then piece the convolved audio stereo signals back into one stereo audio file. While conceptually straightforward, it took me a considerable amount of time to figure out how to best implement it in Python, but after one late night, or should I say early morning, a function was birthed that accepted a single wave audio file, a directory to the BRIRs, and the desired path to where the convolved audio file should go. Since it's almost the holiday season and my poor engineering student soul is yearning for a reprieve from the projects and homeworks that I have been assigned, I selected one of the only songs that instills joy even in the most discouraged individuals. Listen to the music with your heart and soul while you cast your eyes across the time response of a section of We Wish You a Merry Christmas. Notice how the song kind of seems like it's originated from inside your head. Now let's convolve a bunch of impulse functions with this song. For this next clip, I spun the music counterclockwise from 0 degrees through all the negative angles and then backwards through all the positive angles until I returned to zero. Listen very carefully. While it's mostly a clean signal, you can notice some pops when the angles are changing. These pops are because the channel amplitudes are changing abruptly, irrespective to what is happening in the music. To solve this issue, one could use more BRIRs or simply cut the music at appropriate transition points. For the sake of my project, I just divided the signal into equal pieces depending on how many BRIRs were found in the directory, thus resulting in the little pops in the music. There's a lot more I could say about this, as I've really enjoyed learning more about binaural recording and binaural room impulse responses. But for the sake of time, I don't have any more things to say. So if you have any questions, feel free to reach out to me via my email address, caleb.frelick@wallawalla.edu. And while you're at it, check out my GitHub, username is Froka, for more on this project and other neat projects that I've done. Thanks so much.